Swayam Prabha, Digital India, Educated India.
The next important act to be discussed is the Wildlife Act. This encompasses the protection of wildlife, including the plants and animals. This act was passed in the year 1972 to safeguard the wildlife. And keeping this act in mind, many of the areas were declared as protected. As the biodiversity was in a peak, and the biodiversity started having a mild decrease, this act was passed by the Government of India to protect the wildlife. When you just look onto the act, it defines the wildlife terminated, wildlife related terminology. Very particularly, terminating the wildlife, trading of animals, skin, hunting the animals were prohibited under this act. So it defines each and every term. What do you mean by a protected area? What do you mean by an endangered species? How that species requires that habitat? Everything is being given. Initially, a stock inventory is made. What is the existing animal population or the plant population? So they take a census of it and ensure that the wildlife is in a stable position. If there are any perturbances, how it could be safeguarded, how it could be minimized from the external or the threatening forces like deforestation or loss of habitat or habitat fragmentation, whatever it might be. Another thing, this act gives a legal provision for the appointment of the Wildlife Advisory Board, warden, forest guards, their powers and duties, how they should rope in their effort to ensure and safeguard the wildlife. That is being spoken in the Wildlife Act. And it gives a complete list of the endangered wild species of plants and animals. And it is well known that the prohibition of hunting inside the forest area or any other protected area is prohibited. In case of violation of the rules, the hunters or the offenders can be imprisoned and they can be legally sued. If you just look onto the endangered plants, as of now, I'm just giving one or two examples. Pitcher plant. Pitcher plant is an insectivorous plant found in the Himalayas. In fact, it has got a lid, it opens, it has got a characteristic smell, it attracts the flies or insects. When the flies fall in, the lid closes and it digests the insect or a fly. So such endangered plants are becoming very much threatened and they are at the brim of extinction. So trading them is being prohibited. Another thing is Bengal tiger, our Indian tiger, Saras crane, and very many migratory birds also come into India because India provides a good feeding and a breeding ground. So that could be safeguarded through this act. And also keeping this act in mind, they can declare a protected area in the form of a wildlife sanctuary or in the form of a national park or wildlife park. So that is being constituted through the Central Zoo Authority. The Central Zoo Authority comes under the Wildlife Act. Another thing is, it is very clear it imposes a ban on the trade of scheduled animals. Very particularly, rhinoceroses is being hunted. Rhinoceros horn is actually not a horn. It is a cluster of the hair sharpened to form a horn-like structure. In fact, the horn contains medicinal properties. That is a belief in China. So hunting of such animals is highly prohibited and hunting a rhinoceros is equivalent to killing a man. So most of the legal powers to legalize the Wildlife Act or to implement the act is covered under this Environmental Legislation of Wildlife Act. So it provides all the penal procedures for the offenders. Another thing is, it constitutes the zoo. So it allows the captive breeding. If the animals are not found inside the forest, if their habitat is fragmented, an artificial habitat could be made available in the zoo to improve their population. So captive breeding program is also enacted through wildlife. Another thing, Wildlife Act also gives provisions to do research, very particularly to take a census of their animals, their behavior, their interaction with the plants or with the other animals, how are they dependent, how are they interdependent. So such research is being carried out through the Wildlife Act. Another important associated act, more or less related with wildlife, is the Forest Conservation Act. It came in the year 1980 and it conserves all types of forest. Let it be a natural reserve forest or a protected area or a reserve forest or any forest land comes under this Forest Conservation Act. In fact, cutting of sandalwood trees, even if you grow a sandalwood tree at your surrounding, if you want to cut it, you have to get the permission from the forest authorities and they will just cut that thing and it will be accordingly auctioned or treated. Illegal cutting of trees, and very particularly for the commercial timber and trees like sandalwood, is prohibited under this Forest Conservation Act. And the state government is empowered to use the forest only for forestry purpose, not for any agriculture or other thing. That is being ensured with the Forest Conservation Act. Another thing, if any activity has to be carried near the forest, the state government or other thing has to take a permission, conduct an environmental impact assessment, get a prior approval from the central government. Very particularly if there are some developmental projects like mining or digging of constructing of dams or other thing. Another thing, no forest activities, non-forest activities, very particularly setting up of electrical poles, transmission lines, seismic surveys, drilling, hydroelectric projects, they are all not prohibited inside the core forest area. And even the cultivation of the rubber or cash crops is also not permitted because it invites the wildlife to enter into this space and their habitat is actually lost. Another thing, any illegal forest activity, that is what I have been saying, cutting of trees, particularly sandalwood, teak, are being immediately banned under this act. The important aspect we have to note down, that is this, the international treaties or protocols. This treaty or protocol is an international signature which has been signed by very many committees. First thing, Montreal Protocol. This Montreal Protocol was signed in the year 1987. India also signed it. And it was subsequently amended in 1992. The very purpose of the treaty is to stop the ozone depleting substances. How you can treat the ozone depleting substances? That's what the main idea. This treaty was signed on 16th September 1987 and January 18, 1989, it came into action. And this treaty is structured around several groups of halogenated compounds, particularly the fluorohydrocarbons, very particularly the halogenated hydrocarbons. Chlorine or bromine were given priority because those are the ozone depleting substances of the stratosphere. We understood that ozone is a fine layer present in the stratosphere. It protects the earth by filtering the harmful ultraviolet radiations emanating from the sun. Human-induced accelerated ozone depletion happens through the letting of halogenated hydrocarbons, which can bind with the ozone. It never allows or dissociates ozone. The formation of ozone is being prevented and the ozone is being dissociated into nascent single oxygen and oxygen. So this is the problem we have encountered with the halogenated carbons, particularly chlorine and bromine, with the ozone. So that is being monitored, and plans have been implemented to completely phase out the ozone depleting substances. This Montreal Protocol was first, the meeting was first held in Helsinki in May 1989, and it underwent 7 revisions at London, Nairobi. They were taking a list. These are the major chlorofluorocarbons used in this particular country. How to phase it out? So then subsequently it happened in Copenhagen, Bangkok, Vienna, Montreal, Beijing. This chlorofluorocarbons has got a lot of industrial applications. Particularly, it is used as a coolant in the refrigerator. It is used as a coolant in the air conditioner. And it is also used in flame retardants. Whenever there happens a fire, flame retardants they used. Paints, pesticide manufacture. So they wanted to totally phase out that. So they kept specific responsibility to phase out the ozone depleting substances. So they gave 3 important framework. One is control of the ODS trade, in the sense import and export of the ozone depleting substances between the country or inside the country has to be vigilantly monitored. What is the data available? They have to make a stock inventory of it. So they should report the data annually. Second thing, unless is it being licensed. So a national licensing system is implemented for very many countries which signed the treaty to control the ozone depleting substances export and import. So these 3 frameworks initially helped to monitor it. In addition to that, to clear the chlorofluorocarbons, they had a chlorofluorocarbons phase out management plan. Since they are the major thing, it aimed at control its emissions. So a panel was set up, very particularly a technology and economic assessment panel was established, which was a technical and an economic advisory body which identified or helped very many countries to modify the the economy of trading as well as the technology of synthesizing it. So at the request of the parties, in fact, this technology and economic assessment panel, popularly called as TIAP, had alternative technologies, and it tried to eliminate the use of CFCs. And every year the technical issues encountered either in the synthesis or minimizing their production or finding alternate solution were analyzed, and the exemptions were given based on the case-to-case based analysis, very particularly for methyl bromide and other thing, because methyl bromide can create a severe toxicity. And this Montreal Protocol has to be found to be innovative, and it is one of the major universal ratification by all the countries. It leveraged, because if the countries participated, technologies were available to minimize its use, and it sent clear signals to the globe that unless the ozone depleting substances are being controlled, their emission or their synthesis, unless it is being kept in control or reduced, it is very difficult. The ozone layer will get completely deteriorated, or completely the ozone layer will get depleted. This is what the signal that has been sent. And keeping that in mind, now people have found that the stratospheric ozone level has been improved. The declination or the decrease in the ozone concentration is stopped to an extent. The next protocol is Kyoto Protocol. This came in action to take a step against the climate change. People felt that there is a severe climate change, and frequent droughts and improper distribution of rainfall is happening. So this international treaty was signed at Kyoto, under the United Nations Framework Convention on Climate Change in the year 1992. The main goal was to reduce the greenhouse gas emissions based on the scientific consensus. In the sense, transportation we cannot avoid. Can we use greener fuels in the transportation? Can we implement cost-effective desulfurization technology to clean the coal? And global warming is occurring, so people accepted it. And what are the causes? Anthropogenic causes are predominant. The people accepted and started looking onto the reduction in the emission of the greenhouse gases through various anthropogenic activities. So the goal was to lower the emissions, particularly carbon dioxide, methane, nitrous oxide, sulfur hexafluoride, hydrofluorocarbons, perfluorocarbons. These are found to be the major greenhouse gases. Carbon dioxide, although it is considered to be a minor gas present in the atmosphere, the emission rate through the industrial activity or transportation, which happens through incomplete combustion, the release of carbon dioxide is major. And they have found that this carbon dioxide emission has to be controlled. Can we keep some sort of carbon credit? If you just look onto the carbon credit system, one country A is emanating, for example, 1000 ppm of carbon, and the other country is emanating only 800. So the 200 ppm of carbon emanated from one country, can that credit goes to the second country? So in a simple understanding, so to have the carbon credits to have uniformly distributed in the nearby parting countries, so that the carbon overshoots could be minimized. Keeping that, the European emissions trading system was jointly implemented with very many countries. So how best the emissions of carbon dioxide could be reduced? That was the second thought process in the second primary mechanism being set. Another thing, what are the clean development mechanisms available? Can we convert ourselves into a renewable source of energy? Keeping that, the solar came into very more into practice, and solar based vehicles, scooters, changes in the engine, and catalytic converters were some of the advancements which came to reduce the emissions of carbon dioxide majorly through the transporter. And coming to another important thing, to conserve the biological diversity, in the year December 29, 1993, it came into action. The main objective is to conserve biodiversity. How we can conserve it? In situ or ex situ? Before making them into in situ or ex situ, take a census of the wildlife population. Let it be animal or a plant. Look onto that. What is their number? So first, a stock inventory is being made. How best we can sustainably use the components of the biological diversity? Commercial logging should be minimized. Can you go for an artificial agroforestry? And if the benefits are coming, how best these benefits could be equally distributed and these genetic resources could be well utilized? That was the three main objectives of this Convention on Biological Diversity. This Convention of Biological Diversity had seven thematic programs. First thing was agricultural biodiversity. What is the crops that are available? What is the variety we are using? Are they pest resistant? Are they could able to give good yield? Or they require more amount of fertilizer? That is being looked on. Dry and subhumid lands biodiversity. So very particularly, the humid lands has to be rejuvenated. Because of the poor rainfall, the moisture content of the soil is being very poor. Nutrient availability is also poor. How to rejuvenate back the environment? Then inland waters biodiversity, particularly protecting the lakes, ponds as well as wetlands. Forest biodiversity, whether deforestation activity is happening, whether forest fragmentation has already happened, how it has driven any of the species to extinction or near extinction. Islands. Islands are surrounded by water. So how they are interdependent? Are they influenced by any other external forces? how the natural forces could be balanced. For example, tsunami or a cyclone. Marine and coastal biodiversity, very particularly the coral reefs. Because a simple understanding of the coral reef is, they provide a platform or they provide a breeding ground for the fishes to lay the eggs. So corals and fishes have a beautiful interaction. The fish population could be also balanced and improved. In turn, it has got an economic benefit to humans. Mountain biodiversity. Whether any urban sprawl is noted in the mountains, whether it leads to any sort of landslides. So all these things are being worked out, charted out, and that is being implemented. And what are the actions through the biodiversity treaty is to establish a system to the protected areas and the ecosystems. Can it be mapped? Second thing, what are the policies that are available that are giving incentives to the local tribal people, thereby how best we can use the biological resources in a sustainable way. So we are not depleting the biological resources. It is being equally shared and it also goes to the next generation. Specific national biodiversity action plans. Project Tiger, Project Lion, Project Elephant, Project Rhinoceros. So these are some of the projects initiated by the Ministry of Environment and Forest to conserve the biodiversity. Awareness is created. June 5th is the World Environment Day. So during that day, can we create an awareness to the people to create an action towards the conservation of the natural resources? School children in the form of competition, paintings, quiz. So thereby the whole biodiversity awareness can be implemented at the grassroots level. So these are some of the actions taken by the biodiversity, dictated by biodiversity, and it is being implemented at our nation. Another thing, how to restore the habitats that have been degraded? Can we clear the weeds? Can we provide a supportive environment? What are the threatened species? Take a census of it. And preserve the knowledge and practices of the indigenous people, because the tribal people are associated with the local natural reserves. So they have a good interaction with the surrounding. So they better understand the wildlife than a common man. So how to respect the ownership of the genetic resources of each country, and if there are technologies available, how best we can share with the underdeveloped or the developing countries. So these are the things noted by the biodiversity treaty. So in summary, we just see what is an environment, how the environment could be legally protected. So that speaks on the Environmental Protection Act. Air and Water Act by and large speaks on the prevention and control of pollution. So you have to restore the wholesomeness of air or water. And the act very clearly defines the terms for each and everything, industry, occupier, like that. What is a wastewater? What is a flue gas? Everything is being done. And it is implemented through the Central Pollution Control Board, which gives you a directive, training, lays down the standards and coordinates with the State Pollution Control Board. It advises both the central as well as the state government to take an action against the violators. The violators or the offenders can be penalized. Legally, they can be imprisoned. Next comes to protect the wildlife and the forest. Wildlife and Protection Act and the Forest Conservation Act, it clearly says that non-forestry activity should not happen. The forest life should be prevented. Endangered plants or animals, the stock inventory is made. You can go for captive breeding program in the zoos. In the case of forest, non-forest activity, very particularly transmission lines, hydroelectric construction, any development project which involves a pathway inside the forest should be stopped, or a special exemption or prior approval is required from the central government. In addition to that, on a global way, we find three major treaties enacted at the universal world level. First is your Montreal Protocol, which aims in reducing the ozone depleting substances. Kyoto Protocol speaks on the reduction of the greenhouse gases, very particularly the carbon dioxide. How best greener technologies, eco-friendly mechanisms could be jointly implemented among the countries so that the greenhouse gas emission could be lowered. In addition to that, to maintain the wholesomeness of the biological diversity. So, a convention of biological diversity is being signed and it gives some notifications or it gives some directives where you can conserve the biodiversity under the seven thematic approaches. For example, you can look on to the island biodiversity, marine and coastal biodiversity, agricultural biodiversity. All these things have been listed out. What are the provisions being applied to safeguard the natural resources and the people who are associated with it, very particularly the tribals? Their indigenous knowledge should be recognized and they also have to be taken as a part and kept in confidence to maintain and balance the biodiversity. So these are the things that we spoke on. So the take home message is, law is available. These laws should give an awareness to the student. And on an examination point of view, these laws are very important. Unless you specifically write it and say these are the laws, that shows that you are aware of the law and you are responsible in taking care of that law. So that is a point to be noted. Ultimately, it gives you an awareness. Legal provisions are there. Violation of legal provisions can make you into a serious punishment, or the offense can lead to an imprisonment. That is the main idea behind in saying about the environmental legislations and the policies available at the national and at the international level. Good morning, everybody. I am Jay Kumar, Assistant Professor in Environmental Science at Geetham University, Bengaluru. At the outset, I would like to thank Dr. B.S. Balaji of JNU and DTH Swayamprabha MHRD New Delhi for permitting me to present this lecture. In today's presentation, we are going to discuss on nature reserves and what is the nature reserve, why is it called as a nature reserve, and in the nature reserve, how the tribal populations enjoy their rights and what rights are there given by the Constitution of India, and what are the human-wildlife conflicts that is being noticed in India, what are the reasons, and what are the measures to minimize the human-wildlife conflict. These are the things we are going to discuss today. When you say something called nature reserve, it could be a wildlife refuge, it could be a wildlife sanctuary, it could be a biosphere reserve, or it could be a natural preserve or a natural conserved area. By and large, if you just look at the term, in its broader sense, it is a protected area for wildlife, particularly plants and animals. And it is exclusively reserved and managed for the purposes of conservation. By and large, in situ conservation happens in the area. Because of the fragmentation of the habitat, if animals could not able to survive, their area has been earmarked and their boundaries are set and converted into a natural reserve. And because of this natural reserve, we could be in a position to take a stock or a census of the existing wildlife, let it be a plant or animal or a bird, and they could be used for further research. How is their behavior? What is their ecological role? How their dependence or interdependence helps the biodiversity conservation? So these are some of the possibilities of research which we can conduct in a natural reserve. Another thing, they also give us the baseline for toxicology. Since they are coming from a pristine area, their body levels could be treated as basic background levels for any toxicological analysis in the event of poisoning or in the case of an undefined unfixed death. Another thing is, this nature reserves fall under the category given by IUCN. So whatever the species, whether they are critically endangered or near threatened or other thing, all the species enjoy a good level of protection inside the nature reserve. And these nature reserves are surrounded by villages. By and large, the tribal belt is surrounding a nature reserve who depend on these forest resources for their livelihood. Of course, Indian forests are a home for hundreds of millions of indigenous tribal people, officially designated as scheduled tribes, notified tribes, and the indigenous people are called as Adivasis, and about 100 million of the people live around them, stands at about 100 million, and 250 million people live in and around the forests of India, make a complete tribal belt. These tribal population have got some rights which are included in the Section 3, one of the Act. It is given by the Constitution of our India. First right says that a indigenous tribal person or a community has got the right to hold a land because it may be a self-cultivated land, very much essential for their livelihood, and the members can get a benefit out of it. So it means that he can hold a land near a forest area. So that gives a certificate of ownership to the tribal people. Second thing, earlier zamindari systems were there. Many of the zamindari systems encroached a forest area and throwed away the rights of the tribal communities. So the zamindari system is abolished. So now their community rights such as nistar are revived. Another thing, since they are holding a land, their ownership is assured. As a result, they can enter into a forest, collect, use and dispose the minor forest products. For example, a tribal population can enter into the forest, collect the worn out or the waste tree material like the broken twigs or other thing, or the fallen down leaves, or the fallen berries, or amla, whatever it might be, lemons, they can collect it. That could be used for their livelihood. So they go in a traditional manner within or outside the village boundaries to collect these materials, at least at the vicinity of the forest or at the starting of the forest. And they can also make their cattle to go around the nearby adjoining pasturized areas for the cattle to graze the green pastures or the grasslands. And another thing is their community rights are reserved. As a result, their settlements can also be made into a seasonal form. So after the rainy season, when there is a good flow of water, they can also collect the fishes from the nearby water body that is closer to your village. So this is applicable in the case of most of the nomadic communities. So they can settle, they can collect the water resources. In addition to that, the rights including the community tenures, in the sense they are habitat for the primitive tribal groups, which are generally not notified. They may be living inside the core of the forest or inside the mountainous region. So these pre-agriculture communities, their rights are also conferred. Another thing, any disputed land or other thing, they can claim their right. The government can issue a patta or a lease or a grant towards the particular land used by the tribal people, by any of the local council or by the state government authority. So they can claim their land or convert the land into a patta based land. Another thing is they have got a settlement. They have got a right to settle, and they can also convert the local forest villages. Many of the unsurveyed villages can be given some sort of education, awareness, employment opportunities, and that is also being given by the government of India. They can also have the right to protect. In fact, the indigenous tribal people are in close contact with the wild life or the nature. So they have got a better sense of understanding with the community forest resource rather than a common man. So they can be given some sort of an employment opportunity in the form of a local level forest guard, so that they can help us to identify where these animals are there, how best the animals and plants produced could be sustainably used. So that is also a right given in this Scheduled Tribe Act. Another thing, they are recognized. And wherever their rights of tribals could be used in either in traditional or customary law, their customs, their hierarchies are recognized and respected by the district council or the regional council or the state council for tribal welfare. Another thing, they have got a good biodiversity, they have knowledge over the biodiversity. So the access to biodiversity and the intellectual property over the land and their traditional knowledge has to be retained. That might help us to safeguard the biodiversity or the forest. And you might be aware of that. There are many tribal people, you should have heard about this. Tribal people, when they die, their body is being buried in the soil. Their kith and kin plant trees or saplings that will grow over a period of time, and they worship the tree that they are their ancestors. They in fact perform their rituals like marriages or other things before the tree, respecting the tree. If the tree leaves or twigs falls on them, they feel that they are being blessed by the ancestors. That way they are being closely interlinked or entwined with the biodiversity. So their cultural diversity has to be recognized, and it is recognized by these rites. And another thing is, if the tribal people are being involved, most of the tribal people are not involved in hunting or trapping the animals or extracting any part of the body or other thing. So they have been given education and awareness to conserve the biodiversity. In fact, the local people exploit them, but they are considered to be the offenders and being stopped. Whenever their poverty is being exploited, such undesired happenings like trapping or hunting of animals happen. So they have been given adequate awareness over the thing. In fact, they have got better indigenous knowledge about the biodiversity than us. Since they are located around the forest village, you could find they often encounter with the wildlife. The wildlife could be majorly in the form of predatory animals like a tiger, lion, bear, jackal, whatever it might be, or large mammals like elephants coming into their particular place, or wild boars or other birds or animals which create a menace in their agricultural land. What is the reason for this human-wildlife conflict? First thing, the size and quality of the existing habitat for a wildlife is reduced because of deforestation, or it because of the encroachments, or the protected area is not notified, or the agricultural land gets expanded. They continue to improve their agricultural land, expand their land for improving the produce. On the other hand, because of improving the produce or other thing, the agricultural land contains good nutritious food abundantly. In fact, that invites many of the animals like elephants, which go for a crop raid. So another thing is the social organization of a given species. Generally, the animals live in a group. They migrate in a group. When they migrate in a group, they require food on a large quantity. So that behavior, without understanding, elephants go in largely in a group along with their calf, or sometimes a single tusker comes and rampages the land. So their behavior and social organization of a particular species has to be understood. Another thing, predators generally come as individual. They accept jackals who are group hunters. Predators come in generally in individual to in search of food. Another thing, there are a lot of social factors like poverty. So the people try to encroach inside the protected area to collect the food produce. In the event of collecting the food produce, they get injured by the wild animals. And another thing, this is an argument being said. Only the human population is growing high. Do you find a wildlife animal population? That's a question. But still, this debatable issue, by and large, if you just look on, over the last decade, human population has also increased. The wild animal population has also got increased. Only thing, because of equal growth, or we cannot say it as an equal growth, an uneven growth, there happens a conflict. And most of the time, it has led into the injury of the wildlife. Very rarely, humans get injured. So this is again a point to be noted. If you just look onto the human wildlife conflicts that is being lifted, whatever it might be, the list is showing that tiger, leopard, lion, elephant, wolf, all these things are involved in cattle lifting. They attack the livestock, they lift the goat, and sometimes it also bites or creates an injury to the humans. They may be man-eating. They may even lift the infants or the child, especially in the case of wolf. In the case of bear also, it causes a lot of injuries to humans because of the smell or the food they are having. And another thing is deer, antelope, wild boars, they come in a large group. They create a burrow in the agricultural land, create a rampage. They eat the tumors and they come in the group, very particularly the wild boars. Their lower jaw is very strong enough. When they come in a group and if they wanted to be chased away, they create an impact and they create a serious injury on the humans, even to the death. Leave alone the larger animals. Another thing is reptiles. Often agricultural lands or the protected lands is invaded by poisonous snakes like a cobra or it could be a python. So people, without understanding that, they just beat, injure or kill the animal, very particularly bats and birds. Peacock. Peacock is our national bird. In fact, that goes and eats the bajra grains or other thing. So the farmers intentionally or unintentionally spray pesticides or keep a poisoning of the bird. So thereby even the bird population is put into trouble. So there happens a human wildlife conflict. Very particularly we get a trouble with the elephants, which we will discuss it in as a case study. Now, by and large, if you just look on, the human-elephant conflict is one of the major conflict observed in India. What are the trouble we are facing? We are having severe economic losses. The crops are damaged. When a large mammoth enters into the agricultural land, it completely rampages. It pulls all the grown-up crops, throwing here and there because of its annoying behavior, and creates a problem to the property and livelihoods. And they occasionally, not occasionally, most of the times they create a harm to the humans because they annoy them. And sometimes in the event they create a death to the humans. Both the ways it happens. Because of this trouble, severe frustration or anger, the most of the villagers, without the knowledge, they keep an electrical fence to injure the animal. Because they have to save their livelihood, they have to save the crops. Once the elephant rampages the agricultural land, it is a big task, labor consuming exercise to keep the land proper and set right. So the problem is the elephant enter into the thing because of their shortening of their route. Another thing is spread of agriculture into wildlife habitat. You are expanding the agricultural land. An elephant, one of the elephant expert, when we were happened to discuss with him, he was saying that normally an elephant walks about 45 kilometers a day. He is an elephant expert, mammoth expert. He says that the elephant goes in search of food, water, and the advantage that we gain from an elephant is something super. It is the natural wildlife gardener. A gardener goes around the garden, manures it. In fact, the dung of elephant is the highly nutritious fertilizer which acts as a natural gardening process over the forest. So when their habitat is shortened, their movement area is called corridors. When the corridors are blocked, their movement paths are blocked. And if they get packed in the protected area because of the habitat loss and other reasons like poaching for their tusks. So these animals get annoyed in search of food and water during the season, very particularly during the summer season. They move towards the agricultural lands to eat the edible plant called bamboo. Bamboo is their favorite food, and also in search of water. So there happens the human wildlife conflict. Another thing is human activities such as logging may disturb the elephants, pushing them into the closer proximity with the human settlements. Another point is artificial water sources, which I have told you, they came to take water during the drought season. And most of the cultivated crops are nutritious, fibrous, silaceous, And to eat these wild grasses also, these animals come into for crop raiding. And this also give them a good source of protein, sodium and calcium. So the animals enjoy eating that, so they come for a crop raiding. Another point to be noted, so what is the solution for this human wildlife conflict? First thing, the movement of the animal should be marked. That is where this nature reserve gives you a possibility of research to take a census and make an idea how they interact with the surrounding. So their movement pathway is called corridor. Are their corridors free? Whether you have got an encroachment, whether there is any agricultural land nearby. So no activity should be permitted in the corridors. Wildlife Act and the Biodiversity Conservation Acts should be largely implemented, and the awareness also has to be maintained. And whenever the victims get an injury, adequate compensation should be provided to the people. So these are some of the solutions observed to manage the human wildlife. To summarize the whole thing, we could find what is a nature reserve. A nature reserve is a specifically reserved and managed to conserve the flora and fauna which are facing the process of endangerment. And another thing is, they provide an opportunity to do research. Surrounding the nature reserve, there is a good forest tribal belt. In fact, 100 million of the indigenous tribal people called Adivasis live in the surrounding forest area. They do have their rights and they are very more involved in the conservation of the biodiversity. Their rights are being assured by the Constitution of India, where they can hold a particular land, conduct agricultural activity, depend on their minor produce for their livelihood, and they play a major role in conserving the biodiversity. And they have been given awareness to stop hunting or collecting any endangered plants or animals. And since they are surrounding the area, most of the indigenous tribes often experience human-wildlife conflict. The human-wildlife conflict happens through very many wildlife, and elephant human-wildlife conflict is one of the major conflicts observed in India. The reason behind is expansion of the agricultural land in the forest region, or shrinking of their habitat. Since the animals are packed in a closed zone, they try to move around, their habitat gets fragmented, and the crops that is being grown are nutritious and palatable, so they invite the animals, and the elephants keep a crop raid. And in the event of chasing the animals, they get annoyed, they intervene back and give a injury to humans. So very many methods have been adopted to solve this problem, and most of these solutions involves the mapping the corridor of the elephant movement. Thereby you can understand their movement and keep water holes or other feeding grounds specifically away from the agricultural land, and keeping them fences or giving them compensation for the wildlife. So these are the solutions being proposed for human wildlife conflict. The take home message is, we should understand the wildlife, appreciate them, recognize them, and this is again an awareness to the students. So human wildlife conflict also happens in India, and we should rope in our effort in the form of protecting these plants and animals, appreciating the biodiversity. That's the take home message. Thank you.